In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. Dearly beloved, Christ our Lord says in the last chapter of Matthew, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit." In the last chapter of Mark, our Lord promises, "Whoever believes and is baptized will be saved." And the Apostle Peter has written, "Baptism now saves you." The Word of God also teaches that we are all conceived and born sinful and are under the power of the devil until Christ claims us as his own. Therefore, depart, you unclean spirit, and make room for the Holy Spirit in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Receive the mark of the Holy Cross upon your forehead and upon your heart to mark you as redeemed by one redeemed by Christ the crucified. Depart, you unclean spirit, and make room for the Holy Spirit in the name of the Father and the Son and of the Holy Ghost. Receive the mark of the cross upon your forehead and upon your heart to mark you as one redeemed by Christ the crucified. Depart, you unclean spirit, and make room for the Holy Spirit. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Receive the sign of the cross upon your forehead and upon your heart to mark you as one redeemed by Christ the crucified. Let us pray. O Almighty and Eternal God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we pray on behalf of your servants, Kayla, Timothy, and Zayden, who ask for the gift of your baptism and desire your eternal grace through spiritual rebirth. Receive them, Lord, according to your promise. Ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and it will be opened to you. Now give your blessing to them who ask and open the door to them who knock, so that they may obtain the eternal blessing of this heavenly bath and receive the promised kingdom that you give through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty and everlasting God, according to your strict judgment, you condemned the unbelieving world through the flood, yet according to your great mercy, you preserved believing Noah and his family, 8 souls in all. You drowned hard-hearted Pharaoh and all his host in the Red Sea, yet led your people Israel through the water on dry ground, foreshadowing this washing of your holy baptism. Through the baptism in the Jordan of your beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, you sanctified and instituted all waters to be a blessed flood and a lavish washing away of sin. We pray that you would behold Kayla, Timothy, and Zayden according to your boundless mercy and bless them with true faith by the Holy Spirit, that through this saving flood, all sin in them, which has been inherited from Adam, and which they themselves have committed since, would be drowned and die. Grant that they be kept safe and secure in the holy ark of the Christian church, being separated from the multitude of unbelievers, and serving your name at all times with a fervent spirit and joyful hope, so that with all believers in your promise, they would be declared worthy of eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the gospel according to St. Mark. They brought young children to Jesus that he might touch them, but the disciples rebuked those who brought them. But when Jesus saw it, he was greatly displeased and said to them, "Let the little children come to me, and do not forbid them, for such is the kingdom of God. Assuredly, I say to you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child will by no means enter into it." And he took them up in his arms, put his hands on them, and blessed them. Let us pray together the Lord's Prayer over these baptisms. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Kayla, Timothy, and Zayden, do you renounce the devil?
Yes, I
renounce him. Do you renounce all his works?
Yes, I renounce them.
Do you renounce all his ways?
Yes, I renounce them.
Do you believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth? Do you believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried? He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. Do you believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting?
Yes.
Kayla, do you desire to be baptized? Step forward to the font. Kayla, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. The Almighty God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has given you the new birth of water and the Spirit, and has forgiven you all your sins, strengthen you with his grace to life everlasting. Timothy, do you desire to be baptized? Timothy, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. The Almighty God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has given you the new birth of water and the Spirit, and has forgiven you all your sins, strengthen you with his grace to life everlasting. Zayden, do you wish to be baptized? Zayden, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. The Almighty God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has given you the new birth of water and the Spirit, has forgiven you all of your sins, strengthen you with his grace to life everlasting. Amen. Peace be with you, and depart in peace. We now rise for the introit as printed in the bulletin insert. Come, Holy Spirit, fill the hearts of the faithful. O Lord, how manifold are your works in wisdom, have you made them all. These all look to you. When you give it to them, they gather it up. When you send forth your Spirit, they are created. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be. Come, Holy Spirit, fill the hearts of the faithful. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. O God, on this day you once taught the hearts of your faithful people by sending them the light of your Holy Spirit. Grant us in our day, by the same Spirit, to have a right understanding in all things and evermore to rejoice in his holy consolation. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. The Old Testament reading for the day of Pentecost comes from Genesis chapter 11. Now the whole earth had one language and the same words. And as people migrated from the east, they found a plain in the land of Shinar and settled there. And they said to one another, "Come, let us make bricks and burn them thoroughly." And they had brick for stone and bitumen for mortar. Then they said, "Come, let us build ourselves a city and a tower with its top in the heavens, and let us make a name for ourselves, lest we be dispersed over the face of the whole earth." And the Lord came down to see the city and the tower, which the children of man had built. And the Lord said, "Behold, they are one people, and they all have one language, and this is only the beginning of what they will do. And nothing that they propose to do will now be impossible for them. Come, let us go down and there confuse their language, so that they may not understand one another's speech." So the Lord dispersed them from there over the face of all the earth, and they left off building the city. Therefore, its name was called Babel, because there the Lord confused the language of all the earth. And from there, the Lord dispersed them over the face of all the earth. This is the word of the Lord. The epistle lesson is from the book of Revelation. When the day of Pentecost arrived, they were all together in one place. And suddenly there came from heaven a sound like a mighty rushing wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. And divided tongues as a fire appeared to them and rested on each one of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Now there were dwelling in Jerusalem Jews, devout men from every nation under heaven. And at this sound the multitude came together, and they were bewildered, because each one was hearing them speak in his own language. And they were amazed and astonished, saying, "Are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear each of us in his own native language? Parthians and Medes and Elamites and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt, and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabians. We hear them telling in our own tongues the mighty works of God." That all were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, "What does this mean?" But others, mocking, said, "They are filled with new wine." But Peter, standing with the 11, lifted up his voice and addressed them, "Men of Judea and all who dwell in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and give ear to my words. For these men are not drunk as you suppose, since it is only the third hour of the day. But this is what was uttered from the prophet Joel. And in the last day it shall be, God declares, that I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. And your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. And your young men shall see visions. And your old men shall dream dreams. Even on my male servants and female servants, in those days I will pour out my spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I will show wonders in the heavens above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and vapor of smoke. The sun shall be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the day of the Lord comes, the great and magnificent day. And it shall come to pass that everyone who calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. This is the word of the Lord. I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. With the heart one believes and is justified. The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 14th chapter. Jesus answered him, "If anyone loves me, he will keep my word, and my Father will love him, and we will come to him and make our home with him. Whoever does not love me does not keep my words, and the word that you hear is not mine, but the Father's who sent me. These things I have spoken to you while I am still with you. But the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all that I have said to you. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. Not as the world gives do I give to you. Let not your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid. You heard me say to you, I am going away. And I will come to you. If you loved me, you would have rejoiced because I am going to the Father, for the Father is greater than I. And now I have told you before it takes place, so that when it does take place, you may believe. I will no longer talk much with you, for the ruler of this world is coming. He has no claim on me, but I do as the Father has commanded me, so that the world may know that I love the Father. Rise, let us go from here. Here endeth the gospel. Let us confess our faith together in the words of the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible. And in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Ghost of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again, according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sitteth on the right hand of the Father. And he will come in glory to judge both the quick and the dead, whose kingdom shall have no end. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Lord and giver of life, who proceedeth from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spake by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. There is a great irony in the American church today, whether it is in conservative American evangelicalism or the Pentecostal movement or mainline Protestant liberalism. There is a great deal of talk about the Holy Spirit, perhaps more than at any time in church history since the 4th century. And yet, there perhaps has never been a time in which the Holy Spirit's person and work has been so misunderstood by Christians. A study conducted by Ligonier Ministries found that over 50% of self-professed American evangelicals said that they thought that the Holy Spirit was more of an impersonal force rather than a person. And over 50% said that he was not God in the same sense that the Father is God. That is a strange thing to say about the third person of the Holy Trinity. They perhaps are not aided by many newer translations of the Bible, which in their zeal for erasing gender-specific language to make it more inclusive, intentionally mistranslate Jesus' words in our gospel text today. Jesus says, "He, namely the Holy Spirit, will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all that I have said to you." Instead, many modern translations read, "It will teach you all things," thus depersoning the divine person. Or from the side of Protestant liberalism, I had the misfortune of seeing a video recently of a couple newly elected bishops in the ELCA, in which they explained that we need to follow the leading of the Holy Spirit. And then they began to chant, "Let her out! Let her out! Let her out!" thus identifying the Holy Spirit with a supposed feminine aspect of the Godhead. Now, St. Paul says, all Scripture is breathed out by God. And we could even translate that all Scripture is spirited out by God. And Peter says, no prophecy was ever produced by the will of man, but men spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit. In the Scriptures, the Holy Spirit calls himself He. And we are all so concerned with pronouns these days, so let us use the Holy Spirit's preferred pronouns. Thank you very much. But on a more serious note, can we say that it is anything other than blasphemy for the church to change God's own confession about himself in order to fit in with our modern culture? It is certainly blasphemy. And Christ gives a serious warning to those who would blaspheme against the Holy Spirit. Take heed, dear children, lest you be carried along by the spirit of this age and not by the Spirit of God. It is not just the Holy Spirit's person that is under attack, but also his work. Again, among Protestant liberals, it is common to justify departures from the clear biblical teaching on things such as sex, gender, and marriage by an appeal to the Holy Spirit. The claim is that the Spirit guides us, leads us, directs us, and speaks to us through culture. And thus, when the church approves a same-sex marriage or the ELCA develops a liturgical rite for the affirmation of gender transition, they're simply following the leading of the Spirit. "Let her out," as those bishops chanted. "Unchain the Spirit from the dead letter that he has written in the Bible by the prophets, apostles, and evangelists." Luther did not set us free from the tyranny of the papacy so that we could be bound by a paper pope, it is said. And yes, I have heard the Holy Scriptures referred to as a paper pope in several publications. We need to see that what she is doing in the new age is the call. I've heard Brian Wolfmuller, pastor down in Texas, recount one such conversation that he had with an Episcopalian priest, and his response was brilliant. The priest told Wolfmuller that he believed that the Spirit speaks to us through culture. Now, Wolfmuller had just returned from a missions trip to Africa, and he said, "You know, I was just in Africa, and their culture seems to really support traditional family values. Why is it that the Spirit, according to you, only seems to speak through liberal white culture. You know, I think your Holy Spirit is racist. which would be the case. But of course, the Spirit does not speak to us through culture. The Apostle Paul warns us not to be tossed to and fro by the waves and carried about by every wind of doctrine, by human cunning, by craftiness and deceitful schemes. The Greek word translated here as wind is pneuma, which is the same word used for spirit. So we can equally say that we are not to be carried along by every spirit of doctrine, by human cunning, by craftiness and deceitful schemes. And that is what all these claims are that say that the Holy Spirit is speaking to us through culture. They are the doctrines of a false, malignant, and evil spirit devised by human cunning, craftiness, and deceit to turn us away from the Spirit's word in the Holy Scriptures. Jesus says, "The Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all that I have said to you." And again, Jesus says, "When the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you into all the truth. For he will not speak on his own authority, but whatever he hears, he will speak." The Spirit does not speak his own words, but he speaks the words given to him by Jesus. He points to what Jesus taught. If someone comes to you and says that the Holy Spirit has said such and such through culture, but it is not what Jesus has spoken, I can guarantee you that it is not the Holy Spirit speaking. It is another spirit, the spirit of this age, the spirit of Antichrist that speaks. Take heed, dear children, lest you be carried along by the spirit of this age rather than the Spirit of God. So too, in conservative American evangelicalism and Pentecostalism, the work of the Spirit is misunderstood. Yet they claim to be the greatest champions of the Spirit. I have been to many non-denominational worship services where all they talk about is the Holy Spirit, the miracles of the Spirit, the visions given by the Spirit, the Spirit's leading them. The prayers are to the Spirit, the songs sung to the Spirit and about the Spirit. The sermon preaches the Spirit, the Spirit, the Spirit. And Jesus is hardly mentioned at all in the whole service. Heck, Calvary Chapel, one of the largest associations of non-denominational churches with 1,600 congregations, doesn't even put a cross on their churches, but replaces it with a Holy Spirit dove. Jesus says, "When the Spirit of truth comes, he will glorify me, for he will take what is mine and declare it to you." During the Last Supper, Jesus is exasperated with his disciples. He says, "Have I been with you so long, and you still do not know me?" But he promises them that the day is coming when they will finally know him. And that day is when the Spirit comes. On that day, they will truly believe in him. The Spirit's work is to point to Jesus, not to himself. The Spirit's work is to reveal Jesus and teach Jesus' words, not his own. Jesus says, "When the Holy Spirit comes, he will convict the world concerning sin and righteousness and judgment, and he will take what is mine and declare it to you." What does that mean? The Holy Spirit will convict the world concerning sin because he will preach the law, saying, "All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. You cannot save yourself. You are in need of a Savior." The Holy Spirit will preach the gospel. He will convict the world concerning righteousness because there is no condemnation for those in Christ Jesus. The Lord Jesus has died for your forgiveness, risen for your justification, and he has been glorified and ascended to the right hand of the Father. Jesus says he will take what is mine and declare it to you. Namely, he will take my righteousness and my life, which is properly mine, and he will give it to you. What will the Spirit preach? He will preach Jesus. The Spirit's work is to glorify Jesus. As Jesus says, he will glorify me. If you are in a church that preaches the Spirit, the Spirit, the Spirit, and Jesus is an afterthought, if the cross of Christ is removed by a Holy Spirit dove, you are in a church where the work of the Spirit is quenched. For he testifies about Christ. A perfect example of the true work of the Spirit is seen in our Acts reading. Those disciples who were hidden behind closed doors for fear of the Jews, those disciples who, despite the resurrection, were still in the darkness of unbelief, are filled with the Spirit. And what do? They burst out onto the streets and began to proclaim the mighty works of God in Christ Jesus. The Spirit has worked two miracles here. First, he has given the apostles the gift of tongues, so that the gospel, the good news about the resurrection of Jesus, might be immediately proclaimed to all the crowds gathered in Jerusalem and spread throughout the empire. Second, the Spirit works the miracle of faith. The unbelieving hearts of the disciples are made new. They doubt no more. They fear no more. They hide no more. Carried along by the Spirit of God, they began to preach and proclaim Christ. Peter preached. This Jesus delivered up according to the definite plan and foreknowledge of God. You crucified and killed by the hands of lawless men. God raised him up, loosing the pangs of death, because it was not possible for him to be held by it. This Jesus, the one foreseen and forsworn by the prophets, and is exalted to the right hand of God, this Jesus, whom you crucified, is both Lord and Christ. Now, when the crowds gathered around them heard this sermon preached by Peter, they were cut to the heart, and they cried out to Peter and the rest of the apostles, "Brothers, what shall we do?" And Peter said to them, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is for you and for your children and for all who are far off, everyone whom the Lord our God calls to himself." Here we see the true work of the Holy Spirit. Carried along by the Spirit of God, Peter proclaims Christ crucified, Christ dead, Christ risen, and Christ glorified. The people are cut to the hearts. The Spirit convicts them of their sins. And Peter proclaims the gospel. Be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins. And it is not just the forgiveness of sins that God gives. We live in the last days, as Peter says, when the Spirit of God will be poured out on his male servants and female servants alike. Peter says, be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Kayla, Timothy, and Zayden, today the Holy Spirit has been poured out on you in the lavish washing away of your sins. He has given you a new heart to trust in Jesus. He works the miracle of faith in you so that you might receive Christ's grace and Christ's mercy your whole life long. Listen, dear children, all of you, let yourself be carried away by the Spirit of God. Trust in Jesus and proclaim his name. Amen. You may rise for the offertory. Let us pray. Gracious Lord, your Spirit fills the world and gladdens your church with the remembrance of all Christ Jesus has spoken. Comfort us with divine peace, and do not let our hearts be troubled or afraid. Lord, in your mercy. Heavenly Father, as you once chose apostles to proclaim the resurrection, so open the mouths of your pastors and people to declare his praises to all who will hear. Especially, we pray for David and Barbara as they bring your word to the people of Macau. Lord, in your mercy. Lord God, sustain those who are mocked for believing and confessing the truth of your word, that they may remain faithful to you. Lord, in your mercy. Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, you have poured out your Spirit upon us that we might believe your truth and raise your sons and daughters in it. Bless all parents that they may faithfully catechize their children in your word. Lord, in your mercy. Lord of might, preserve your people from their enemies, bring peace to the nations, and prosper the cause of life. Bless our leaders, especially our President Joe, our Governor Mike, the Congress, legislature, and all the judges and magistrates. Give them a relentless pursuit of just laws for the common good of all, with a heart of mercy for the weak and vulnerable. Protect and guide those who defend our country, especially Sean, Austin, and Thomas. Lord, in your mercy. Lord of compassion, forget not the sick and the suffering. Grant them healing according to your will. Especially do we name before you Karen, Harold, Esther, Jim, Aubrey, Barbara, Charlotte, Maya, Wanda, Kenny, and Patricia. Give them confidence that you know their need and will supply them with all that they need to endure to the day of your coming, when all afflictions will end and you will grant the perfect consummation to us and to all who have loved your appearing. Lord, in your mercy. Lord of grace, your Son has come among us and given us the privilege of a place at his table. Prepare us to receive his body and blood with repentant hearts and faith for our good and for the flowering in our lives of your holiness and righteousness. Nourish and feed us that in this holy communion we may be strengthened for your service. Lord, in your mercy. Almighty Father, with your Son, Jesus Christ, send your Holy Spirit into our hearts through your word to rule and govern us according to your will. Comfort us in every temptation and misfortune, and defend us against every terror, that we may continue steadfast in the faith, increasing in love and good works, and trusting firmly in your grace for us by his death. Obtain eternal salvation through the same Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks unto the Lord our God. It is truly meet, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks unto thee, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty, everlasting God. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify thy glorious name, evermore praising thee and saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Our Lord Jesus Christ, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me. After the same manner also, he took the cup when he had supped, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, Drink ye all of it. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the remission of sins. This do as oft as ye drink it in remembrance of me. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ given unto death for you. Take the true body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ given unto death for you. Take the true body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ given unto death for you. blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, shed for you for the forgiveness of all your sins. Take, drink the true blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, shed for you for the forgiveness of all your sins. Take, drink the true blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, shed for you for the forgiveness of all your sins. Take, drink the true blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, shed for you for the forgiveness of all your sins. Now may this body and this blood strengthen and preserve you unto life everlasting. Depart in peace. body and this blood strengthen and preserve you into life everlasting. Depart in peace. Body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ given unto death for you. Take and eat the true body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ given unto death for you. body of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, given unto death. Body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, given unto death for you. Thank you, the true body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, given unto death for you. Thank you, the true body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, given unto death for you. Thank you, the true body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, given unto death for you. Body and this blood strengthen and preserve you into life everlasting. Heart in peace. Welcome to the Lord's table. Thank you, the true body of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, given unto death. give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good. We give thanks to thee, Almighty God, that thou hast refreshed us through this salutary gift, and we beseech thee that of thy mercy thou wouldst strengthen us through the same in faith toward thee and in fervent love toward one another. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who liveth and reigneth with thee in the Holy Ghost, ever one God, world without end. The Lord be with you. Bless we the Lord. The Lord bless thee and keep thee. The Lord make his face shine upon thee and be gracious unto thee. The Lord lift up his countenance upon thee and give thee peace. Thank you for joining us for this blessed feast of Pentecost this morning, when we celebrate when the Holy Spirit descended upon the disciples as if flames of fire, and they proclaimed Jesus' work to the people in Jerusalem, and the church grew by 3,000 in that one day. And on, of course, this Pentecost, we remember that every time someone is baptized, there is a personal Pentecost, right? That the heavens are opened up and the dove descends upon them. The Holy Spirit is given according to God's promise, so that the true miracle of Pentecost, which is faith in Jesus, can be worked. And so we give thanks for this feast and, of course, for the gift of baptism this morning. Some announcements. Make sure you're getting registered for VBS. The registration forms are on the back, and you can get them to Holly. We want you signed up, and we want the kids here so we can all have a lot of fun coming up. Let's see here, the orphan grain train, there's details about that. Ladies' aid, this is important. You got a little insert in your bulletin this morning. So ladies' aid, of course, does a lot of things to help keep the church running and make sure that things are going well, and sometimes we don't realize all the good work that they're doing for us. And one of the things they do is they provide the food for funerals, for the grieving family, so that we have a time to celebrate the person's life, and also, of course, their victory over death in Jesus Christ. And so, like this last week, sometimes we get clusters of funerals together, and it can be quite overwhelming for our ladies. in the Ladies' Aid. So we would like you to fill out this sheet here in your bulletin with your name and phone number and any services you would be willing to provide in case of a funeral or that sort of thing, like bringing pies, bringing salads, being willing to serve. Or if you're unable to help, that's fine, but let us know. Just so that when Karen has a funeral coming up and she needs to find people to help out, that she has some numbers that she can call to get that food together and prepared. Let's see here. Am I missing any other important announcements? Okay. For you guys who were baptized this morning, I have some gifts for you after the service, so don't take off too quickly. And I have some paperwork for you guys to fill out, so don't leave before that so we can get that done. For next week, because we have another baptism next week, and the next week after that, and the next week after that. So we have lots of baptisms this week, lots to rejoice over. Okay, depart in peace.